good morning, everybody. We're going to get started here. Welcome to Sunday service on Mother's Day. We've been sharing in the chat together about memories of our mothers, things we're thankful for, anything else, any other thoughts about mothers. We are just so grateful for all the mothers that are here with us today and that are not here, and the impact and the profound love that they've had on our lives throughout the years. And so we're just so grateful for them, and we're glad for them. So today is the day to celebrate you, and we're so so thankful for that, and so thankful for you. So welcome this morning. This is week, I lost count of our virtual services, so we're happy that you're here with us, and we're glad that you can be a part of this today. And with that, John has the worship ready, and let's worship together this morning.
Grace. This is amazing love. ones worth crown with thorns is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at His feet we bow. The one who wore our sin and shame now robed in majesty, the radiance of perfect love now shines for all to see. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. Your name is victory. All praise will rise to Christ our King. We'll be right back.
Awesome. Thank you, John and the band. I had a great time this week getting back into it and playing. I have to say, being there firsthand, it is amazing the amount of work and effort that goes into it. I felt like I was on TMZ or something. There was like five or six cameras surrounding the stage. There was lights. We were just missing a director and a grip to complete the setup. So really grateful and thankful to John and the rest of the band every week for going and recording the music. And it was just a great time to worship this week. So we hope that you enjoyed that as well. Again, we're really grateful. Today is Mother's Day. So we want to just say thank you and welcome to all the mothers. We want to just recognize you for your love and your care and your sacrifice for other years. And if you would like, continue to share memories and thoughts on mothers in the chat as we go through the service today. That would be great. Love hearing and seeing the stories and their memories and the just the favorite things about mothers. So we would ask you to continue to do that as we go throughout today's service. Just a couple of announcements today. So as you all know, we have a new property and a house and land that we're actively working on. And so there has been a sign up genius that's out, and we'll make sure we share the link this week on Facebook. But just quickly and easily, this week, JD is going to be at the building at the new location on Tuesday and Thursday from 1 to 7. So we'll make sure the link gets posted. But if you want to go and help volunteer and take on some of the tasks we have that are needed, you can do so. So again, that is this week, Tuesday and Thursday from 1 to 7. So we'll get the information posted to Facebook. We'll get the sign up genius link. We'll be able to have you help in very socially distanced ways. But we would love to have anybody who is willing and able to come out and help. There's a lot of work as we begin to, you know, prepare the space. And then as we think about and figure out how we're going to transition from where we are now to the new location. And then just as a reminder, every week we have our post-service connection. And so I've posted the link in the chat, and then the link is also pinned to the top of our Facebook page. So we would love to get to see you immediately following the service. It's been a great time where we get to connect. Everyone gets on video if you feel comfortable, and we talk and share and just hang out for a few minutes post-service. So look forward to that. So if you would like to join, the link is in chat. We'll post it again towards the end of the service. And it's also pinned to Facebook. And then last but not least, it's time for our offering. And every week, I walk everyone through, and I'm going to do it again today, how you can give online. And you can also still give physically as well if you wanted to mail a check to the church. But if you go to our Eastpoint website, it's eastpoint.org. And then you can either go to the main website, or you can even do eastpoint.org/give, and it'll take you right to the page. If you click on give, it takes you into the page where you can go ahead and get to the app that we partner with, so Give Online. Once you're here, you can select the fund that you want to give to. You can select the amount, and then you can put in your payment information down below and hit submit. As a reminder, we did have someone that volunteered to match donations. I believe it was up to $10,000. And so those donations are for people who have been impacted by COVID. We have several members in our church that have been impacted, who are out of work and who have other issues going on. And so these funds given are to help those folks. And so if you would like to give to that, that would be fantastic. And in the spirit of transparency, I don't think it's a surprise to any of us that over the last few weeks, the last couple of months, our offerings have gone down. And we know that people are impacted, and we're not expecting, for those that have been to give. But if you can give, we encourage you to give, just because, as we've mentioned before, we're still paying rent on the current building, and we're in the process of trying to get out of that lease. But, that's an expensive location. And then the other needs and things the church has, ministries we support and areas that we impact, are still happening. And so we really just ask, graciously that if you can give, please give. And if you can't, we understand, and we don't want you to feel pressured. And in fact, we want to help you. And so if you've been impacted by this, you can reach out to the church, and we can figure out how to connect you to the support you need. But with that, I'm going to pray for the offering, and then JD can bring the message. God, we just thank you today for who you are. We know that in the midst of all this craziness, God, you are still there. You are in control, and you are steadfast and firm, Lord. And we just ask right now that you would just please bless those who have been impacted by this virus, God, that whether it's illness or it's a loss of job or wage or our family members who have been impacted, God, we just pray that you would please be with them, comfort them, strengthen them, and just help them through this time, God. For all of those who have not but are still impacted mentally, or emotionally, God, there's just so many impacts that are seen and unseen to this, Lord. We just pray for them as well. Right now, God, we focus and pray for Eastpoint as we are in a period of transition, an exciting period of transition where we are moving from one location to another, to a place that we can call home that is ours, Lord. We pray that you would just help the situation with the lease, that we can negotiate our way out of that, and then we can also find the right way to meet in the interim until we can be at our new property, Lord. Pray for the property itself as those who are volunteering to go and help clean up and to prepare, Lord, that those go well and smoothly. We just ask that you bless those who are volunteering, God. And we ask today for the money that's given, that you would just please multiply those funds, God, in many ways so they can impact and support the ministries here at Eastpoint and impact those who need it most, God. We're just grateful for who you are. We're grateful for times like this that we can meet together and be in your presence, God. And we just love you and thank you and praise you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Yeah, I'm muted. Okay. Well, good morning, Eastpoint. Good, happy Mother's Day to all you moms out there. Josh, I'm impressed with how quickly you changed shirts from a t-shirt playing the drums to that nice dress shirt while hosting us. That's very good. It's mad skills to be able to change that quickly. And Xander, I like the man bun. I saw that on there. I don't know if that's a factor of just not showering while we're in this time off, or if that's, you know, don't have a barber, but very hip, wearing a man bun. Josh mentioned we're doing demolition, we're doing yard work. Happy to have anybody out there to help out. Just let Lori know. I don't know what we're doing with the sign-up genius. It apparently didn't work so well this last week. Nobody could find it. But if you, Lori, kind of making sure that we don't end up with 15 people there breaking the law. So if you let her know that you're coming, she'll make sure that we keep within the regulations of how many we should have. That's Lori Hill. Maybe if you stay for the thing afterwards, we'll get specifics about how you contact her on that. And in terms of the building rental, the lease that we're trying to get out of, I met with Leslie, our landlord representative, on Tuesday or Thursday, one of the T days. And she says she should have a word for me this coming Tuesday on at least the 5,000 square feet on the one side. It's so that we're getting that. And then we also took another group through there for the other 10,000 square feet because the other people are having a hard time getting their act together. So any part of that we can get rid of, it's great because that'll give us the chance to lower our bills and keep our fees down low. So we're working on that. We'll get there. So keep praying for that. Pray that this new group that walked through it will be wanting it and we'll take it. We would love to have that taken care of. So we're going to be talking about Mother's Day today. Mother's Day is, I realize, a very sacred holiday and it's very important. Some people say that on Mother's Day, we are celebrating mothers. I wonder if not on Mother's Day, is it we've taken one day to try to atone for a year's worth of neglecting and taking advantage of mothers, because they do a very thankless task most of the time. And it's good that we do honor them and celebrate them. We shouldn't wait for that, you know, second Sunday in May. We could also find some other times when we could do that for moms and let them know they're appreciative for all they do. I was looking at a whole bunch of different quotes on Mother's Day this past week as I was looking at some different things. And I found a couple that I really enjoyed. There's one by Milton Berle, if you remember Milton Berle and watching him on TV in black and white. So not all of you will remember this. He says, if evolution really works, how come mothers only have two hands? And I thought that seemed to be right on track because moms could use sometimes about five or six hands, or maybe like an octopus having eight hands, because they're doing so many things at the same time. So it's a tough job and it's a thankless job. And people like to read, sometimes like there'll be many churches that are preaching on Proverbs 31 today. We are not going to be in Proverbs 31, just FYI. But for those that are in Proverbs 31, because they read about the virtuous woman, and it's funny because that word virtuous, when used in reference to a woman, is translated as virtuous. When the same word is used and they're talking about a man, they translate it as like with valor or strength. So I think that those things are also very true of women, of the valor and strength. But I know that most women read that and say, this isn't about a woman. This is about Superwoman. This is really intense stuff here that feels like it's like almost impossible to live up to. And it can feel that way. And that's why another one of the quotes that I picked for today that just to share with you is it says, there's no way to be a perfect mother, but in a million ways to be a good one. And that's something to keep in mind is that as moms, perfection and being doing all the right things is a great way to drive yourself crazy and for you to jump into that thing that we all know as mother guilt, where you take on responsibility for everything everybody in your family does and think, oh, if I were just a better mother, this wouldn't have happened, which is almost never true. I mean, certainly we could all be better parents. That's always true, but you can be a good enough mom. And I think that's one of the things to struggle for. You notice I got a new background today. Judy said this would work because I've got pictures of the kids in the background. They were just little wee little whippersnappers. They're knee high to a grasshopper when these pictures were taken, but they're still my kids. And so that's my contribution to Mother's Day here. So I'm going to tell you a story that you know. And it's a story, it's going to be in 1 Samuel chapter 1. And the very first verse says, there was a certain man. And it goes on to talk about this guy, Elkanah. And it talks about his pedigree. And verse 2 kind of sums up a lot of what you need to know about him. Because verse 2 says, he had two wives. Now, so we know that he wasn't the wisest man in the world. Because having two wives is just asking for trouble. And to everyone's shock and surprise, they didn't always get along. The one wife was known as Hannah. She had no kids. And the other one was Peninnah, and she was having kids without any problem. She had lots of kids. And this caused a lot of friction between them. Now, being a mother is important to a lot of folks. It's a really important thing. But what we find is that back in these times when it was going on, this is not even first century. This is in the BC stuff or BCE, if we're using the current terminology. And in these times, if a woman didn't produce children, her husband could just say, well, you know what? This isn't working out. I'm going to get myself another one. I need another wife because what you're supposed to do is give me children so I can pass on my name. So chauvinism has been alive and strong for a long, long time. And it would come to, you know, and there would be times when Peninnah would be basically mocking Hannah and she would just kind of rub it in that, hey, you know, because Elkanah loved Hannah more than he loved Peninnah, but Peninnah was the one producing the kids. And so she was sort of saying to Hannah, you know, yeah, you know, he might love you, but you're certainly not able to do anything that he needs for him because you're not producing any kids. And so Elkanah comes on to Hannah and she's crying and she's weeping. And they've just had one of these routs that they've had, these rows of, you know, who's got kids and who's the better wife. And he starts, why are you crying? Why are you upset? And he says one of these classic male chauvinist things that is just shows where his whole perspective is on life. He says to her, hey, you have me. Isn't that better than having 10 sons? Like, whoa, you know, hey, babe, look, you got all of this. You know, why are you worried about having kids? And I think that Hannah's response to this, which is kind of interesting, is that, of course, she doesn't suddenly go, oh, wait, you're right. How lucky I am that I have you, Mr. Sensitive, to just be there for all of my needs. Because she still was like, I feel unfulfilled. I want to have children. And so you guys know the story. They go up every year to sacrifice at the temple, and they went out while they're there. Hannah went in to pray because she was really upset because at this time, there's a big emphasis at this feast that they go for upon the fact that like all the children receive blessings and stuff, but she doesn't have any children to get a blessing. She doesn't have children to receive food at the feast. So even though Elkanah gives her a double portion of what he gives everybody else, it doesn't fill the hole that she has for wanting children. And I know that there are plenty of women today who want to have children. and they can't for whatever reason. And we've got all kinds of modern stuff that helps us to, if it's possible, to kind of coax those children into us and then out of us. But she couldn't have it. And so many of you who can't have children, maybe, you know, maybe many of you are just not even watching today because it's too painful to be doing church on Mother's Day. I do know of people who refuse to go to church on Mother's Day because they're not mothers and it hurts too much. And I'm sorry for that. You know, I wish we didn't have that, but unfortunately pain and disappointment and things not going as they should is now the norm, not the exception. It's the way the world works. And that's what these guys are having to deal with and what they're up against. So, you know, and so she's upset while she's there and she goes to the temple and she's praying and she's upset. And as she's praying, she's moving her lips, but she's not saying anything. And so, you know, but what she's praying is, and she's kind of making a deal with God, but she says, answer my prayer and give me a son. Now this is in the middle of a deal where she's going to say, if you will answer my prayer and give me a son, I'll give him back to you. He'll spend his whole life working for you, you know, being at your service. But I think it's kind of, the funny part to me is how Elkanah's saying, hey, aren't I better than 10 sons? And the next thing we hear Hannah saying is, Lord, answer my prayer and give me a son. Clearly, he's not better than 10 sons. In fact, she's happy to have one son. If you just give me one son, God, that, you know, I will give him back. I'm so desperate to have children. And so it's to me, showing that, no, he's not enough. He's not going to be good. And it's so important for a mom to be a mom. Now, and you guys know the story that, you know, it says in due time, in verse 20, in due time, Hannah conceived and bore a son because she had these interactions with Eli, the priest at the time. And he was saying, hey, God's going to answer your prayer. And he did answer the prayer so that by that next year, she had a child who could go up, but she didn't go because she said, I'm not going to go up until I weaned him, because when I go up, I need to give him back to the Lord. And this is a thing I think is really hard for us to understand. How does she give up her son? She wanted a son so desperately. Then how does she turn around and give him up to be raised by a priest in a temple? And she sees him once a year. She brings him a little coat, a little robe that she makes for him. He was probably somewhat of a toddler when he went there because of the fact that it was after he was weaned. Now, they probably nursed a little longer than we do because they don't have things like formula and baby food at those times. So they would have nursed for a longer period of time. But still, we're talking about a little guy that she's having to drop off to be raised by the priest. And this sounds in so many ways like it's difficult or awful, but we never have any record of Samuel being upset by this. Eli accepted the responsibility of raising this child, which is interesting because he had two sons who were already grown. They were full grown men because he was an old guy, and his sons were just, they were priests because of their lineage, but they were terrible guys. They weren't believers. They didn't follow God. And they did all kinds of inappropriate things. And they took advantage of people. They took advantage of the sacrifices and took the best parts for themselves. They ate things they weren't supposed to eat. They weren't supposed to eat the blood of animals, but they did. They weren't supposed to eat the fat portions because that was supposed to be given a sacrifice. But they ate the fat portions because we all know fatty meat is more flavorful than totally lean meat. If you don't know that, you got to, you know, start experimenting more with your cooking. That fat gives it the flavor. It cooks it into that, makes it very tender. And so they didn't obey any of those things. In fact, they would even take the temple workers that were there, the women that would work at the gate receiving different things, and they were sleeping with them. And they were living awful lives. And we don't know anything about their mother, but we know that Eli, he was upset about it, but he really didn't stop it. He would complain to them and say, this is terrible what you're doing. You shouldn't be doing this. But in the long run, what happened is that they just got away with it. He would complain about it. And we know that Eli was a very fat guy. We find that out later on. You're going to have to read further into the book to see how we know that he's fat. But he's apparently, as these guys are doing their different stuff, that maybe they were just sort of feeding some to Dad as well. That he would tell them, you shouldn't be doing this stuff. Is he stuffing a nice big, you know, thing of roast in his mouth that was stolen from the altar? So we don't know exactly how much participation he had, but we know that God was upset with him for not dealing with his sons. And this is who was, in essence, the surrogate father for Samuel. And Sarah, like I said, she came back and visited him every year, but she didn't get a chance to live with him. But it shows something, I think, extraordinary of a mother's love. Because while she didn't get a chance to see him all the time, she said that the best thing I can do for him is obey God. In fact, the first year when she didn't go back to worship with the rest of the family on their annual pilgrimage, Elkanah, her husband, he said, you know, are you coming? She said, no, I'm not going to come until I've weaned him. He said, well, you do what you think is best. But he also adds the warning of, but keep your deal with God. You know, you don't mess around and make a deal with God and then back out on it. Keep your agreement with him. Follow through with what you said you will do. And if you do that, you know, that's fine. Then you can do it. But she did keep her deal with God. And she did. She said, what's going to be best for my kids is what God has called me to do. And if I do what God has called me to do, then I can know that I'm doing the best mothering that I can do. The best mothering I can do for Samuel is to do exactly what I've agreed with God I was going to do and trust that God will take care of him. And of course he did. Samuel is like one of the big Bible heroes, one of the best Bible heroes. We pretty much know bad stuff about everybody. And Samuel is one of the few that we don't hear much negative stuff about him. He was just like a true guy. He did the right thing consistently. He would get upset sometimes. He would, but by and large, he was a righteous man all the way to his death, and he led the entire nation. He led Israel, not as their king, but as a prophet who would be able to tell them what was going on. And this is something that I think that Hannah can take great pride in, because she was his mother, and it was her faithfulness to God that allowed him to go on and be that, become this man that he became. Now we know that Eli did die on the same day with his sons. And it was a thing that God prophesied. He prophesied it to Samuel when he was just a boy, probably about 12 years old. And he prophesied it to Samuel that this was going to happen. And Samuel told Eli, because Eli required him to. And it came true. And so that was, you know, just one of those things where Samuel being used by God from a very early age. What a lot of people don't realize, because the story of Samuel is so absorbing and it gets you so caught up in it, is that Hannah stayed fertile. She ended up having 5 more kids. And we don't necessarily read about that. We don't know a lot about it, but she had more children. And we don't know how they all ended up, but we do know that Samuel had brothers and sisters. And he didn't grow up with them per se, but he had them. And Hannah was blessed with a family of children. And I think largely from her faithfulness to God, because the way the scripture puts it is it said that God remembered her. God remembered her. And I think what a wonderful thing to be said about somebody. Wouldn't you love to have it say, you know, that God remembered, you know, Bob, God remembered Carol, God remembered, you know, Joan, whatever name that you want to stick in there for yourself, you know, just that God remembered you and that he listened to your prayer and he responded. The reality is God does remember you. He remembers everything about you. And he wants, as moms, he's not looking for perfect moms. He's not looking for you to do all the right things. He's looking for you to depend upon him. Now, I don't doubt that, you know, that Hannah made plenty of mistakes as a mom. I'm sure she did, because she's human. She made mistakes with Samuel. She probably got upset with him at times when it was out of proportion. And we all know how babies can be upsetting. When they cry and they scream and you can't figure out what's going on, you think that they've eaten, you think that everything's okay, but you don't know what's going on. The diaper's dry and yet they're still screaming. And it gets very frustrating. They're not doing something wrong. they have no way to communicate what's going on for them, but it can still get us to right to the edge. I know that I've been right to that edge many times with my own kids when they're, you know, when they're doing things and it's not their fault. They're just being human, but it's hard. It's hard. And so God doesn't want you to be perfect, but he does want you to lean on him. You know, I don't advise you to make deals with God like Hannah did. I'm not saying you can't do that. I'm just saying it can be a dangerous thing. For one thing, God's not somebody to be bartered with. He is somebody that if you do make a promise to him, keep your promise. Keep your promise. That I heartily recommend that you not welch on a deal with God. Is welch a term I shouldn't be using? I don't know if that's a politically incorrect term. If it is, replace that with your own word that is more politically correct, and then we'll all be okay. All right. But the God remembers you. He loves you. Even those of you who maybe year after year have prayed for children and don't have any, he remembers you. And maybe what he's letting you know is that the best thing for you is to not have kids. There was a study done, it was in the 70s, and it was in Look magazine. Now, those of you that are older might remember Look magazine, some of you do not, but it was a survey of, they just sent out to thousands of people and said, knowing what you know now, if you're a parent, would you have kids again? And it got published because the results were so startling, because about 70% said they would not have children if they knew then what they know now. Now that's a staggering number. I suspect that there was some test bias in there, because parents who are very happy with their children and doing okay probably don't feel terribly motivated to respond to such surveys. They're like, oh, that's a silly question. But those who are having a lot of upset about it, they're going to be more likely the ones to respond. And so it's a naturally skewed with some self-selection going on there. But in either case, to find out it's a staggering number of people that would say they wouldn't have kids. I think it's a very sad number, because I know for myself, even with the difficulties, even with the struggles that are there that are inherent to being a parent, I can't imagine life without the kids. So I would have them again. And I think that's the way most moms are. Maybe it was mostly dads that were responding to that, saying, ah, oh, they're so expensive. There's, you know, but it's, but I know that for moms, having kids, for most moms, I realize there are some people that are not good moms. And maybe that's one of the things that makes Mother's Day hard for you. Maybe your mom was really rough. Maybe she didn't love in the way that she should have, or maybe she just took off when you were little, or she neglected you in some ways. And that's hard. It's hard to deal with. And then it also makes it so that on Mother's Day, maybe it is hard to celebrate mom when that's what you had. But maybe somebody else stepped into that role. Maybe there have been people who have come along to have been the nurturer that your mother wasn't. But in any case, you try to find who can I be grateful for? You know, and maybe it's just being grateful for the mother of your children. Because I know for myself, I've many years said, I don't have to do anything on Mother's Day. You're not my mom. But she is the mother of my children. So I think that she is deserving of some pampering today. And all the rest of you guys who are trying to get yourself off the hook saying, you know, either, you know, hey, my mom's dead, so I don't have to do anything today, or, you know, I already sent a card to my mom. You probably know a mom. If it's not of your kids, you know moms, and there's a chance for you to be honoring and respectful and thankful to moms, because, you know, I like to read a lot of history. In battles, when these young soldiers are mortally wounded, you never hear stories of kids laying there crying for their dad. They all are calling out for their mothers. When there's that kind of hurt, they're crying out for their moms. Battle-hardened people, has been true throughout different seasons, different parts in history. It's just been one of those consistent things. Soldiers cry out for their moms when they're hurt in battle. That seems to be the most consistent pattern, because moms are the nurturers. Moms are the ones who, for the most part, are there. You know, when they get hurt, moms are the ones to kiss the boo-boo. Moms are the ones to make it better. Dads are the ones saying, you're fine, get up. And moms are saying, oh, come here, baby, let me give that a kiss. And so it's So there's such a crucial role that moms play. We honor you, moms. I encourage you, follow God, lean on Him. Don't try to be perfect. Just try to be faithful. God will give you some things that, you know, He tells us that if we train up a child in the way that he should go, in the way the child should go, which is different for every kid. You can be an awesome parent with one kid, and you have another one, and you got to start from scratch. You can't just do all the same things. Some of the same things will work, but every kid is different. And so moms get to know their kids, and that's what makes them so special. So I want to thank the moms that are out there. I want to encourage those that are not moms that maybe this is the best thing for now, and you can be that surrogate mom for people that have poor moms, or you can, there's a lot of ways to mother, and you know, and grandmothering, because I know grandparenting is awesome. So those of you that are grandmothers, there's so much to be said for that. I know that I think we spend more money on our grandkids than we did on our own kids, but it's maybe it's got a stage of life type of a thing, but it's great. So thanks to all of you that are parenting, that are mothering, that are grandmothering, that are just there for those other people. And keep Hannah in mind, that she obeyed God, and her sorrow, her burden of childlessness was lifted. And even though once it was lifted, she gave back to God to make herself once again childless. But then God remembered her and blessed her with another family. So that's where we are for today. Let's just close with a word of prayer. God, I do thank you for the family structure that you have built, that you have made moms that not only give us life, but give life to our living, that just become so much and so all-encompassing to us. And I just thank you for that. I thank you for the sacrifices that we know are daily being made by moms. And most days are done so without thanks, without gratitude, and without acknowledgement. Lord, may today may we be extra careful to acknowledge and be grateful. And may we work on other days to make more days, Mother's Days, when we really do care for and love them. In Christ's name, amen.